Production of Ruckus is made possible through the generous support of Dave and Jamie Cummings, the Hartwig family, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to Ruckus, our weekly food for thought fight over the news of the day and the trends of the times. I'm Mike Shanin. The Ruckettes join me shortly in our topics this week. The mayor's push for a new airport now on hold. The push for a downtown streetcar comes to fruition. And a conservative icon hopes a Trump presidency never comes to fruition, plus roast and toast. But we start with our interview segment and focus generally on the 18th and Vine Jazz District, and specifically on the American Jazz Museum and its new executive director, Cheptoo Kositany-Buckner. Quoted in Jazz Ambassador magazine, she calls for collaboration, saying it is key for cultural institutions, noting that 18th and Vine is an important link not just to jazz, but also to local African-American history and the Boss Pendergast era. Before joining the museum, Cheptoo worked as a deputy director at the Kansas City Library System. Welcome to Ruckus. Thanks for joining us. Appreciate you coming in.
Thank you.
You've been in this job for just a short time, but you've been in Kansas City for quite a while, 20-some years, I believe.
Yes.
What's your take on what's gone wrong at 18th and Vine and why it hasn't achieved the kind of success people were hoping for?
Well, I think part of it also, I think some of it is perception, actually. And I was one of those skeptics before I actually went to 18th and Vine in a lot of ways. I think one of the things that we need to do a better job is really our community outreach and promotion and letting people know what is actually going on at 18th and Vine. Because right now, there is a lot going on. We get about 160,000 visitors a year. We just hosted about 1,000 kids from 45 schools with jazz performance at the museum. We get visitors, all the way international visitors that are coming in.
But I bet you don't get a lot of people from greater Kansas City, or as many people from greater Kansas City as you get from elsewhere.
Not the general tours of the museum, but we get them in the Blue Room and the Gem. And I think that's the question, the point that I want to make is that, you know, as Kansas Citians, we need to embrace the heritage that is jazz because the nation and the international part of the world recognizes 18th and Vine and elevates it and celebrates it. We had a couple all the way from Norway the other day that were coming in to do some history and research about Jay McShane, and they're excited about 18th and Vine. When you talk about everybody, well, do you come from Kansas City? Oh, jazz, 18th and Vine. So I think with us locally, we need to begin to embrace it and really realize that we have a very powerful heritage, and it does elevate Kansas City, and we talk about us as a jazz city.
You're responsible for the Jazz Museum. What else?
I'm responsible for the Jazz Museum, the Jam, the Blue Room, the J. McShane Pavilion, and also the day-to-day maintenance of the facilities in partnership with the City of Kansas City.
But there are other people and other organizations in charge of other entities at 18th and Vine. Is that correct?
Exactly.
Is that what you're talking about, the need for collaboration?
The need for collaboration in terms of working together within the district also, but within working together within cultural institutions. My experience at the library is that one of the ways that the library was really fully successful was it was not a silo. It was a place where we brought people together and connected based on what was important to make a larger impact in the community. And I think for us at the district, we need to collaborate first, but we also need to open those doors to bring other people in and extend our tentacles outside of the 18th and Vine.
You mentioned perception, and from time to time on our program over the years, we've talked about 18th and Vine, and a recurring comment is, there are people who are afraid to go to 18th and Vine. Now, I know the statistics are good, and there's not much crime there. I've been there myself. Mm-hmm. I felt safe and secure. But mm-hmm. is that a problem, people's perception that 18th and Vine is a difficult area to navigate in and you're not safe?
I think that is truly, truly perception. And I think that is one of the most challenges that we have at 18th and Vine is overcoming that perception. But I think we are making headway. We're going to make some headways in doing that. We are, you know, rethinking, you know, how we're doing Fast Friday to connect to the larger community. But I also think that there need to be some kind of exchanges, sort of tourism exchanges within neighborhoods, right, or within the Kansas City region so people can really understand that it is
Johnson County Express coming
John
to the
Blue Room or Blue Room Express going to the Johnson County or whatever. But I think that perception needs to change. But I think the other thing that people need to understand is that's a neighborhood. It's not just an entertainment district. It's a neighborhood. There are people who live there. There is the cooperative that is Parade Park that has been there for years that is very historical in terms of ownership for African Americans. We have apartments where people are living. It is a neighborhood. And so part of our charge as cultural institutions in the district is, first of all, to build that local community and then also build a larger community. But because we are also international organization, especially the American Jazz Museum, we also need to build that international community. But we've got to communicate with people. We've got to engage them and tell them what's going on and bring them there so that they know it is very safe.
Sounds like change is coming to 18th and Vine.
Change is coming.
I hope so.
Yes.
And I wish you good luck in
doing
so.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you for coming in.
Thank you, Mike.
That is Cheptoo Kositany-Buckner, Executive Director of the American Jazz Museum at 18th and Vine. Now let's meet the panel and start a ruckus. Jason Grill is a senior advisor at Paris Communications and the founder of J. Grill Media. Marianne Murray Simons is a freelance writer and consultant. Patrick McInerney is a former prosecutor, now in private practice with Denton's. And attorney Steve Mirakian is with the law firm of Warsh, Hobbs and Mirakian. Welcome. Good to see all of you again.
Thank you.
On paper, Kansas City, Missouri does not have a strong mayor form of government where the mayor serves as CEO and is fully in charge. But Mayor Sly James has a strong personality and a good deal of charm when he wants to apply it and often gets his way at City Hall. But as much as the mayor wants a new one-terminal airport, he has run into strong resistance from some council members, at least one congressman, at least one architectural firm, and a number of voters who want only renovation at Kansas City International, which will turn 44 in November. Facing the prospects of defeat at the polls, James has pulled the plug on any KCI-related election this year. So what now, Patrick?
Well, I think that it's pretty clear that the campaign to undertake the question in 2017 started yesterday, because this is not going to go away. And this was a timing issue. I mean, this was a matter of the message that this is a free airport paid for by the airlines, more convenient, more secure, didn't have time to get out there. And it is a compelling case when you say, look, this doesn't cost a dime of public money, but there wasn't time to get that message out there. And I think, you know, look, this is what you want in public officials. When a guy like Sly James and a council member like Jolie Justice, who chaired the Aviation Committee, look at the prospect of this passing and understand what the reality is and understand that there needs to be more time, it takes some guts, and it took some guts on Tuesday for them to wind this down.
Well, this has been going on for several years, and all along it's been said it costs taxpayers nothing. That's not a new concept, but I've been saying it all along.
Well, whether it's been said all along, the first time that was rolled out in a large public forum was, what, 6 weeks ago?
Yeah.
When Southwest Airlines started talking about it.
It's happened way too fast. There's been no campaign around it, no communications
How
campaign.
How long between now and November? 6 months?
Yeah. I mean,
That's
I would.
That's not
I,
long enough to build public
I would have liked to have seen it on November's ballot instead of August. They went to the council last week, right? And then the next week, they're like, we're not doing this. It was too timed wrong for me.
Could it be, Steve, that people just don't want this new airport?
Well, partially. And I've kind of waffled on it. I'm actually now in favor of the airport. However, I want to say that while I think the mayor made the right decision, I think the problem is twofold. One is people simply do not believe that it won't involve taxpayer money. They don't believe it. Now, I'm not saying anybody's lying. I'm simply saying people don't believe. They think it's going to cost them a lot of money. Secondly, I think when the airports say, or when the airlines say, we're paying for it, they say, yeah, you're paying for it, and then I'm paying for it. Okay, so they think the tickets are going to go up. And third,
tickets are going to go up, not much, but then
a lot of people are also saying, I like the airport the way it is, but they're not really looking at the long-term effect of we have an outdated airport. It could be better and it could be more secure, but they are simply tired of what they believe are boondoggle projects that cost a lot of money and don't really work.
I think the airport will work.
I agree, Patrick.
25 more flights daily in St. Louis, Kansas City, with Southwest, and they could save more money by doing them in Kansas City.
And so the problem is, the mayor thought this was all going to go smoothly, and that's why they weren't promoting it. And now they got this opposition, and now they're kind of caught unprepared.
Well, Marianne, everybody seems to think that the airport does need renovation.
Yes.
I think that's fair. The airlines say they will back the debt if the airport is rebuilt, but won't have anything to do with renovation.
Right.
So who's going to pay for that?
Right.
Well,
nobody.
No, it's not going to happen.
It's not going to be renovated.
That's right. It will just sit and wait until this campaign can be put together.
Right.
And if the airlines will wait and hold their funding,
that's a key question. What, are they going to stick around with their promise,
issue.
With the commitment to pick that?
Right.
A lot of uncertainty now because you have a 2016 elections. We don't know how the market's going to react to that. You're going to have interest rate going up. You're going to have to do this in 2017.
Right.
It's just frustrating, I think, all the way around.
Teresa Lohr will still be on the city council in 2017.
But this wasn't
Catherine Shields will still be on the
city. This wasn't a victory for Teresa Lohr, and it wasn't a victory for all the naysayers.
They were opposed to it.
This was a prudent decision made by the mayor to pull this down. And I think it was, that's what you want in a public
official. It went their way.
Was there enough time for the poll?
Here's what the mayor said. He's dismissed this, but he said in the Kansas City Star a few days ago, if we miss this moment, I assume that means now. If we miss this moment, then the opportunity will be gone for years. Not 1 year, but for years. And KCI will continue to fall behind other cities. A single terminal is inevitable. The question is when. If you think something is inevitable, do it now. That's an advocacy piece.
And he was being an advocate the way he should have. I think the reality is they took a look at those numbers, couldn't get past 40% support, and decided, look, if we swing and miss on this, then we've really got a problem.
That's true.
It's worse.
But the facts weren't out there. The facts weren't out there. These guys studied this for 2 years. That's why they did this so long, is to make sure before they put it out there, they were convinced that this was a slam dunk.
Right.
But they haven't educated those
people. I think they would be better off, and I agree with Patrick, you don't want to swing and miss, but I believe if they really hit it really hard, putting it on November's ballot with a lot of people going to the polls, I think they would win if they promote it properly. And I think waiting for another year, that's a mistake.
I'm going to wrap this up, but Marianne, don't you think the real issue is people don't think it's going to be as convenient as it is now, and they want the convenience?
Well, the naysayers have certainly brought that issue forward. I think the real issue is education and a campaign to really let voters know the positive impact of this and hope that the airlines will still be interested in the time that people understand the importance
of it. One more last question. Jason, Congressman Graves is clearly opposed to this. It's in his district. How important is his support or opposition?
I don't know if it's that important, to be honest with you. The funny thing about this, Mike, is that most cities try to build a Taj Mahal of an airport, and the airlines say, hey, hold back, we're paying for this. We are the opposite, which is just insane to me. We're not going to have a golden parachute airport like the congressman says.
No more last questions. Turning its attention away from Sam Brownback for one editorial at least, the Kansas City Star tells readers the downtown streetcar system could be a big triumph or a big failure. The 2.2-mile line, ostensibly designed to promote interest in a wider system, came to existence in a controversial election raising property and sales taxes in the small areas served by the streetcars. They've been on display undergoing tests for several weeks, but tomorrow, Friday, is opening day, the first time the public can board and ride the streetcars. A party atmosphere is planned for the launch. Supporters believe the streetcars will promote downtown economic development. Critics believe it's a waste of space and money. Who is right, and how soon will we know who is right? Let's start with Jason, then go to Mary.
I think the supporters are right if we look at the economic development that's happened already. It costs $63 million in taxpayer funding to pay for this, and $37 million, I think, in federal grants. There's been a ton of development already. There's $600 million of people investment that's actually said, we wanted this. We came here because of this. There's been about $1 billion in extra economic development as part of that. So that's already happened,
right? Let me understand. They're moving downtown because of the streetcar,
not
because of the P&L district, not because of the St. Helena Hotel, not because of Sprint Center.
All of those things are included, Mike. I think this is an added piece.
So it's not just the streetcar.
It's not just that, but a lot of the developers have said that's one of the reasons, one of the factors, one of the top reasons why they're moving.
And if you look at the line, look at the development right along the line.
Right.
I mean, that speaks for itself. The development is centered along that streetcar line.
So has it been a success that way? Yes. We'll see. If I was in the communications team, I'd have people talking to writers the next few weeks and making sure they'd get all the data to see what they can fix and get put out there. But as far as that, I think it's been a success. Now, it will be a major success, not until we expand it or it goes to the plaza. I mean, but for downtown, it's made it more attractive.
As I said, I asked the same question to Marianne. Which side is right, supporters or critics, and how soon are we going to know which side is right?
I think time will tell that, Mike, but the issue is exactly what Jason and Patrick have been talking about. It's making things happen. right now, and tomorrow is going to be a fabulous day. The weather is perfect. It could not be better. It is Chamber of Commerce weather for the opening. There'll be a lot of people down for First Friday. It's going to be an exciting day in downtown Kansas City. That will bring interest from other parts of the city, not just those who live downtown, but from the metro area, and hopefully those who visit Kansas City who are going to want to be a part of this because it's new and exciting. Your point is well taken, though, Jason. It can't just go where it is now. It needs to have the next phase, and that's what's being talked about currently.
Patrick, was the real reason for starting this line, called a starter line, to cause people to like this and then want to expand the system? Is that the reason, really more fully than the idea of economic development, which was already going on downtown?
I think it's certainly part of it. I think that the initial fight around the money and then the initial fight around the placement was all to get it started, because I think the first step is the toughest step on this. And I think we're going to know inside of probably 12 months whether this is a viable situation, whether it's working, and quite frankly, whether it's fun to be downtown, whether this makes it more fun to be where this is. I think tomorrow is going to be a ball. I think tomorrow you're going to have tens of thousands of people in the center of the city riding the streetcar, going to the events. I think it's going to be a blast. And I think I'm thrilled about that, because it brings people downtown. And again, it builds on this enormous pride that people have in Kansas City. Mm-hmm.
Steve, I have no doubts that downtown will be very crowded on Friday, tomorrow, the first day of the streetcar. What about 3 weeks from Friday? Will it still be crowded?
And that's my concern. I don't think so. I like the idea of the streetcars only because I think if they can develop the line and eventually get it to the plaza, get it out to the airport, get it to where people can really go places. Right now, I think it's a novelty. I think tomorrow will be great. It'll be wonderful. Three weeks from now, I'm afraid the cars are going to be essentially empty, except for a few tourists who are staying up in the main part and want to go down to Crown Center. Quite frankly, somebody very facetiously called it a short ride to nowhere, and quite frankly, right now, that's what it is. But I hope it works. I'm in favor of it. I think it's going to be a year, and it's not going to
be. Is it
going to
benefit
well.
You? Your office is downtown.
It's not going to benefit me at all.
Okay. He's a walker.
I don't have any problem with it.
But here's the thing. I live down there now, and I'm shocked, and I've lived in the suburbs. I'm shocked at how many people come into the city, like, every week at the Kositany's. There's volleyball tournaments, cheerleading competitions. I mean, there's always people down there, even on the weekend.
Now, where do they go, Jason?
They're going to be using that, though.
To go where?
To go downtown from River Market to Crown Center. That's the point, though. It's a starter line.
Go to the River Market.
I hope you're right.
But there's 100 destination points right along the route.
Okay.
I mean,
I hope you're right.
I want to write a play about this someday called A Desire Named Streetcar.
Oh, by the way,
I couldn't wait. By the way, you're right. To some extent that this is triggering other activity, the lady from the Jazz Museum asked me to mention that they're having a First Friday event down there starting tomorrow, tying in with the launch of the streetcar.
I think there's going to be a lot of First Friday.
Kansas.
Great idea.
Yeah.
All right, one of America's leading conservative columnists and commentators, George Will, is offering a unique perspective on this year's presidential election. When Donald Trump wins the Republican nomination, Will urges conservatives to defeat him at the polls, work hard to keep Republicans in control of the House and Senate, and then try to confine Hillary Clinton to one term in the White House. Will says a Trump defeat would be condign punishment for his comprehensive disdain for conservative essentials, including the manners and grace that should lubricate the nation's civic life. Will conservatives listen to Will? Well, let's ask one, Steve Mirakian.
The answer, short answer, is no. No, no, and no to his three suggestions. George Will is a very bright man. I would never try to question his conservative credentials. The problem is that what he's ignoring when he talks about working to defeat Trump is the Republican Party establishment is not going to do that. Trump is the revenge of John Boehner and Mitch McConnell. They love Trump. They hated Ted Cruz. This is their guy. They're not going to work to defeat him. Republicans may want to control the Senate and the House. That's fine. It's nice to say let's work to do that. The reality is Trump is going to lose so badly, he's going to drag them down. They're going to lose the Senate. So now Trump causes us to lose the presidency and the Senate. Once the Senate is gone, you're not going to keep Hillary to a one-term presidency because without the Senate controlled by Republicans, you're going to have gridlock. That means she's going to act by executive action. Her executive action is all going to be approved by the three Supreme Court nominees that she's going to put on there. So a Trump presidency or a Trump nomination is the death knell of the Republican Party. My prediction is 8 years from now, maybe even 4 years from now, you will see a viable third party of some kind, but it's not going to be the Republican Party as we know it now.
Well, then why did Trump beat 17 other Republicans in the election? That's my question. He's proven he can win.
He can win with 35% of people who are extremely angry and who are not looking down the road at what this means for America, and they're saying, we want this guy because he stands up with rah-rah, America first, and says some of the stupidest, most preposterous things, and they're saying, we'll vote for anybody,
right?
Anybody other than someone who actually is a smart person.
Or establishment.
That's right.
Yeah.
He's got 35%. So now where's the other 65% going to come from?
This is chickens coming home to roost.
He's not winning.
I'm not saying he's going to win, but I'm saying we got to give him a little credit for winning.
Well, we don't.
Everybody says he has no chance to win.
He keeps winning.
That may be true, but at the beginning of his presidential campaign, I think everybody who appeared on Ruckus, including the host, said, there's no way that this guy's going to win the Republican nomination, and he won it handily and got more than 30% of the vote in some of the final primaries, getting 50 and 60% of the vote.
But he did it appealing to a base by being divisive and misogynistic and racist and all those things. That doesn't happen on a blank slate. The seeds of Donald Trump and the seeds of that kind of rhetoric have been sown by the Republican Party.
Patrick? For, who?
How about Sarah Palin?
That is such old history.
How about your standard bearer?
She was not
Trump
the standard bearer.
Trump has had her on stage recently.
You know, give me a break. Sarah Palin is not the Republican Party.
That kind of divisive rhetoric is exactly what creates this base that Trump enjoys now.
And nobody on the Democratic side.
But he's going to come back to where he always has been. He'll come to the middle. You know he will. He'll change everything.
I think the most interesting thing that has been said during the process is coming from people who are traveling internationally, and people are asking Americans, who is this Donald Trump guy? What is he doing? You're supposed to be the leaders of the free world, and you're letting this man represent you?
He's an embarrassment.
Yeah, it's bad
news. Let me ask Marianne about Ted Cruz. There was a local connection, Jeff Rowe, a local consultant who has been on Ruckus from time to time, was his manager and did a superb job in getting Cruz a superb ground game and nearly winning the nomination, but he did not. Why did Republicans not like Cruz? He's conservative, he's Ivy League educated, extraordinarily
smart.
He's
not a very likable guy.
Right.
He's just not likable.
So it's personality rather than
I think
policies?
It is.
There's no charisma.
Yeah.
I mean, Lindsey Graham, God bless him.
You listen
to what Lindsey Graham, and Graham's got support, and he's got some respect from both sides of the aisle. He's been around for a long time. And you listen to what Lindsey Graham has to say about Ted Cruz, and what it means is, what he's saying is, jerks don't win. Because I've heard Republican after Republican say, I've heard Republican after Republican say, you know what, I can handle crazy with Trump, I can't handle evil with Cruz.
Yeah, Cruz is not evil.
And you're
but
sorry,
he's not likable.
Sanders is not doing better.
Oh yeah, just crying trouble, every night. No, I think we're all in agreement. It's going to be Hillary Clinton versus Donald Trump.
Okay, now it is
so
time.
What does Bernie do? Does Bernie pivot?
He could be part of this new party.
Bernie is at least true to his principles. He's not.
You'll speak
anywhere.
Among
I'm
yourselves.
Sorry.
I'll continue. Now it's time for Roast and Toast, where the Ruckettes offer a pat on the back or a kick in the pants to people and events of the news. And this time we begin with Marianne.
Thank you, Mike. My roast is for the Kansas legislature and their late night shenanigans that led to a budget that is kicking the can down the road to the governor to make a decision about funding for the state of Kansas. What's being hurt? Education, our highway system, and all that has been good and stable about Kansas. We need to deal with this issue and deal with it now.
Mr. Mirakian.
Donald Trump, your preposterous statement accusing Ted Cruz's father of being in league with Lee Harvey Oswald in the assassination of President Kennedy was a breathtakingly audacious lie that reached a new low even for you. The Republicans had several winning options. Trump is not one of them. So we're left with two equally bad choices. Hillary, a dishonest progressive who was more corrupt than Nixon, and Trump, a lying lunatic populist. Elections have consequences. If we choose to be led by liars and lunatics, we will reap the disastrous harvest.
Jason.
I was going to do a toast today, but I think after our airport debate, I have to do a roast. I just think the whole process with the airport has been, the facts haven't gotten out, and it's unfortunate that the vote was going to happen in August. I wish it could have happened in November, like we had talked about. I'm worrisome that if it doesn't happen next year, it's never going to happen. And just we have so much we can live up to. I mean, the airlines, again, are supportive of this. They're going to pay for it. There's so many facts that need to get out there. And I'm just roasting kind of the overall process of how this went down. I just feel like the voters need to be educated more before we go to a vote. And I'm hopeful that'll happen at some point in the near future.
Patrick,
in a related story, I've got a toast. The decision, the tough decision that city leaders made on this, because I think there was a mounting steamroll toward this vote and toward the effort, and the reality was that, you know, they couldn't get past 40% when it came to the support. So they made a tough call. Mayor James made a tough call. Other city leaders made a tough call to pull the plug and be more prudent about this decision process.
And finally, here is a self-serving toast to my spouse, Joyce, and myself, celebrating our wedding anniversary on this fifth day of May. Married on Cinco de Mayo, 1973, before any of the panelists were born.
Thank you.
We plan to celebrate today in a big way, dinner at Chubby's on Broadway, and staying up late, maybe till 10.
Wow. What a night.
Probably not.
Happy anniversary.
Thank you. And that is Ruckus for this time. We're back next Thursday at 7. Now for the Ruckettes and the crew, I'm Mike Shanin saying thanks for watching. Go ride the streetcar tomorrow and good night.
Production of Ruckus is made possible through the generous support of Dave and Jamie Cummings, the Hartwig family, and by viewers like you. Thank you.